Jehovah, thy name is great. Jehovah, your name is great. Lord, manifest your power on us. Lord, manifest your power on us. Jehovah, thy name is great. Lord, manifest thy power on us. Jesus Christ, your name is great. Jesus Christ, your name is great. Lord, manifest your power on us. Lord, manifest thy power on us. Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you this moment to give you all the praise, all thanks, all honor, all adoration, all supremacy, all power, all might belongs to thee. Be thou exalted in our lives, in all the affairs of men. Let your mercy continue upon the path of the faithful all over the world. We plead also that you show mercy upon the faithless. Almighty Father, we commit our world into your hand. Let your mighty light continue to descend upon the hearts of all men, that man will be lifted up from the dungeon of ignorance, from the dungeon of darkness, and experience the light manifested in Christ and by Christ. This we ask in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Viewers, you are welcome to this episode, to this platform once again. I want to share with us this moment a message on the subject matter of the art of worship. The art of worship. I want to plead with you to listen, because some of us may have forgotten, and some of us, the art of true worship practically demonstrated via obedience to the feet of the Almighty Jehovah God and His Christ, we may have forgotten. It may not even be your fault, because you are not told. You may not have been taught. I want to make it clear to us, if you are a believer, endeavor henceforth to understand the divine essence of the true art of divine worship. Divine worship of the Almighty God is practically demonstrated by our bowing our heads on the ground. When you bow your head on the ground, the Lord told me, say, when man bows his head on the ground, when man kneels down to pray, he receives my blessings, my grace. And when he bows down before me, he receives my peace. So grace, peace, and blessings are all encapsulated, because you can't bow down to the Lord without kneeling down. You can't stand and bow down. Let us stop this act of standing up, sometimes put our hands in our pockets and claim that we are worshiping the Almighty God during prayers. Some of us, we call ourselves big men of God. And so during prayers, you see that some of us will put our hands in our pockets in the altar or in our houses, move around chanting the glories of God. Let that ignorance stop. Let that ignorance stop. Because your duty on earth, my duty as believers, is to find out the things taught by our Lord Jesus Christ. I keep on saying, and put them into practice. It is written in the scripture that they shall be taught by God. Let the Spirit of God teach you. Take this message as not coming from me, man, human being. Take it as something that God is passing through me to speak to you. Since you gave your life to the Lord, how many times have you bowed this your head on the ground to worship the Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth, maker of the sun, the moon, and the stars, sustainer of all that is? Don't say because it is not taught in your church. You wouldn't do that. No, but it's in the Bible. Bow your head on the ground to the Almighty. The word bow, B-O-W, has how many? About 263 matching words in the Holy Scriptures. This Bible we have. When you begin to search into the word, bow, B-O-W, it has 263 matching words. And the angels do it. Part of your duty and my duty is to manifest on earth to the best of our ability, to the best of the knowledge given to us, the will of God on earth, so that it will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. That's what we have in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, that will be done. We say that will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Who will do that will on earth? It's you and I. So we have to study the heavenly activities and put them into practice here in the world of man. If you read the Bible in the book of Revelation, I want to plead with you, don't put this on the platform of doctrine. Mere doctrine. Say, okay, this is not taught in my church. Look, listen to the Holy Scriptures. If you read the book of Revelation chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, you say, and when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fell down before him that sat on the throne and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne. You see, this is what is done in heaven. When the radiant vicinity of the Lord was revealed to St. John in the island of Patmos, he saw, among other things, great ones, the immortal beings, the four immortal beings, as they give glory to the Almighty, sustainer of all that is. You see how the 24 ancient ones, the 24 ancient ones, or the 24 elders, the Bible refers them as the 24 elders. You know, and we know that these are the 24 cherubims and seraphim that guide the cycle of the central sun in the cosmos. They paid their obeisance, such great ones in the higher heavenly realm of light. They paid their obeisance. They bowed as revealed to St. John. What of on earth? It's you and I. Say, let it be done on earth as it is done in heaven. So as a believer, learn how to, in your churches, in your offices, anywhere you are, in your houses, learn how to pay obeisance to them. That is highest demonstration of humility, is to fall down your face on the ground to the Almighty. You will receive more from the throne when you do that with a pure heart. Our fathers on the path of light. They did it as well. What about Abraham, the father of all nations? If you read the book of Genesis, chapter 18, verse 1 and 2, we read, "And the Lord appeared unto him," that is unto Abraham, "in the plains of Mamre, and he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. And he," that's Abraham, "lift up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself towards the ground." The Lord appeared to Abraham. And this Lord, you know, there were three men. One was the Lord himself, and the other ones, they came out, the three of them came in form of men. That's why they, if you read it further, you see how they went to the house of Abraham and ate food and did all that. But when Abraham saw it, he knew that this is the Lord. And Abraham bowed himself towards the ground. He made obeisance towards the ground. You see? That is the right thing to do. Those things, he did that to teach all generations how to worship God. If you read the book of Genesis chapter 19, verse 1, you see, we read, "And there came unto," "and there came two angels to Sodom at eve, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom, and Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face towards the ground." He bowed himself when he saw those heavenly visitors. He still bowed himself and worshiped the Almighty that sent them. Lot did it. You see, Abraham did it. Lot did it. The servants of Abraham, if you read the same Genesis chapter 4, chapter 24, verse 26 says, "And the man bowed down his head and worshipped the Lord." That was the man sent by Abraham to look for a wife for Isaac. That man, following the things, the experiences, he glorified the Lord. What did he do to glorify the Lord? Did he put his hand in his pocket and jump around and claim that he's worshipping God? No. He practically demonstrated the true art of worship. "And the man bowed down his head and worshipped the Lord." That is Genesis chapter 24. Verse 26. Now, if you read verse 48 of the same chapter 24, verse 48, you read, the same man was making a report about his activities. The same man was making a report about his activities. And what did he report there? You let us read it together. Excuse me. Genesis chapter 24, verse 48. The man said, "And I bowed down my head and worshipped the Lord, and blessed the Lord God of my master Abraham, which had led me in the right way to take my master's brother's daughter unto his son." The man reported. He bowed down, you know. I remember I traveled to a particular place. As soon as I came down from the aircraft, I bowed my head unto the Almighty that made the heavens and the earth. And some people, they are Christians. They asked me, "Are you a Muslim?" Why should that kind of question be asked? They ask that question because they don't do such things. But it is there in the Bible. They think it is only the Muslims. Every human being that is in this world, you have to bow down your head to the Almighty God. That is what the Holy Bible says. That was what was practiced even by the prophets, all the prophets of old that believed in the Almighty. Huh? If you read the same verse, if you read verse 52 of the same chapter 24, And it came to pass that when Abraham's servants heard their words, he worshipped the Lord, bowing himself to the earth. If you have forgotten that this is the right thing to do, or if you didn't know, know it from now. And it is expected of you. And it counts much. The highest physical demonstration of humility, physical symbolic aspect of humility, is to lie low and fall on your face on the ground. When you bow your head on the ground and you want to speak to the Almighty, bow your head on the ground. Don't claim to be righteous. Tell him to have mercy upon you. Present your case before him. He will hear you. Because those that worship the Lord and bow their heads on the ground, they are in the forefront, they are ahead of others than those that put their hands in their pockets and move around. Sometimes I go to some places, you see, during say we are worshiping the Lord, people are praying, they are moving up and down, you know, they like that. I say, what is it? They are talking to the Lord of the universe. Where did we learn all these things from? From whom? From where did you learn it? You learn it from your pastor? Is that what the Holy Scriptures? Our Lord Jesus Christ said that if the blind lead the blind, both of them will fall in. If the blind lead the blind, that's our Lord Jesus Christ. He said it. He said, if the blind lead the blind, both of them will fall into this. And what of Jacob? Remember when Jacob met Esau in the book of Genesis, chapter 33, verse 3. You know? Genesis chapter 33, verse 3. What happened? Genesis chapter 33, verse 3. And he passed over before them and bowed himself to the ground seven times until he came near to his brother. He bowed himself to the ground seven times to the one eternal Almighty God, Redeemer of the oppressed, Master of light, Controller of all manifestations. We have to humble ourselves before him and lie low. Bow before him so that you will receive his peace. Lie low so that he will bless your life. Whether or not this is taught in your church, doesn't matter. We are not talking about church. Every church should take note of this. If you are a general overseer, you are well recognized among men, you are the founder of a worldwide church, and you have not taught this, please. And you are the one that people, your members will listen to. If they didn't hear from you, they will not take it serious. Please lead them around. Tell believers, tell them that from now onward, when you come to your churches, bow your heads on the ground to the Almighty God. Lie low before the Almighty. In your houses, lie low before the Almighty. When the spirit of humility is practically pinpointed and demonstrated, mercy comes. A lot of things come. Even if you read the Bible, you see in the case of Ahab and Elijah. Remember when Ahab took the land of one other man, is it Naboth or something, someone. Then he now, prophecy was given by Isaiah. That look at what will happen to you. And the man, when he had it, the Bible says he lied low and he walked softly. He humbled himself. He lied low. And by lying low, Mercy even came immediately. So, okay, this thing will happen, but it will not happen in your time. It was now adjustment was made for the fact that he lied low. Let us not have this demonstration of pride unto the Lord. No. The people of Israel, they knew this, that's the right thing to do. Viewers, I'm not saying that in the art of worship or ministration, that everyone that falls on the ground, they're all experiences related to the powers of light. No. Don't misunderstand me there. But I'm saying that you on your own, learn how to willingly and genuinely on your own fall your face on the ground with the Almighty God. Yes, the Spirit of God in the process of certain ministrations can make anybody to fall down on the ground. The Spirit of the Lord can do that, if that is what the Spirit of the Lord wants to do. But the men of God of our time should stop using that experience as the standard way of measuring anointing. Because that is actually the standard way of measuring anointing, that, oh, this man falls on the ground, this day, that the anointing is there. Then it means that when Jesus Christ was physically on earth, nobody would stand up with his feet on Jerusalem, because that was the highest anointing that time. Everybody will constantly fall on the ground. Nobody, even in your kitchen, along the road, Pilate would be cannot walk in his office, because the greatest anointing was there. That is Christ. So, and now, psychologically, some men of God, when they know that, they feel that, oh, this has become a standard. They're using it to measure the anointing. If people don't fall in my church on the ground, people may think I don't have power. They go to occult, but we give all the power. I gave those things before. People like, there are many traditions that still do it. There are certain things we program it, put it in the handkerchief or anything. Why do you make this fear everybody will like see them fall on the ground? Like, and like I have said, there are also some people who doesn't have any, that they don't even have that occult power to do that. Not that they have the Holy Spirit to do that. So they use their brain. You see, when somebody stands, you don't touch someone like that. Has been slayed under the anointing. Let me tell you, if anointing actually slays you, it will slay off all your problems. So if you say you have fallen under the anointing, and your problem remains, that what are you talking about? What are you talking about? Let's stop all those foolishness and childish behaviors in the name of our. Let us understand the divine part and follow it in the spirit and the truth. There was a man who came, this man of God, and he was fond of doing all those things. So one day, a particular man, a wrestler from Diboland, you know, these traditional wrestlers. In Diboland, traditional wrestlers, when you to defeat a person, is when you succeed in making the person's back to touch the ground. So he saw this wrestler. The man now was invited to one church, and he came. And the man of God was busy making all those things. And cross up some people, push, this one will lie low, this one fall down, this one. Then when he got to that wrestler, the wrestler pinned his leg like this. The man of God, push. Look at that. The man, you know, try to push somebody down gradually. The person, the man. Because when we psychologically, they just feel that anything that makes my back to touch on the ground, yeah, that is a defeat. You know, that is their belief, the traditional wrestling. So the wrestlers, the man of God felt that this behavior of this man is like an embarrassment, because he has to fall down to prove that he has power of God. The man of God started again, ministering to him. The wrestler held himself. The wrestler now organized himself and stood strong with his two legs on the ground. He told himself, "Man of God, Bacharanya." Bacharanya means be careful. Because the wrestler at that moment was interpreting the thing as a wrestling bout. And that if this man of God does not take time here, I will let him know that. I'm a wrestler. I can also lift him up in the congregation and let his back touch the ground, not my own. You see?
These are the things we people may experience along the line of such kind of falsehood and manipulation. And I remember that I also went to one church, you know, one particular church. It's kind of that's how that church is organized, a spiritual church. Even when I was invited to that place, I asked some of my friends, say, no, don't go there. It's a spiritual church. Don't follow the word of Jesus. There. This, and I said, no. What are you talking about? In me, as I'm here in this world, as the habit of the last covenant, this planet, if the prince of darkness, Satan, invite me, say, come and preach. So I am God, I will come and preach, and there are human beings. I will go there. My prayer is, oh Lord, take some souls, bring some souls. I will go there and carry some souls out for the Holy Spirit. Yes. So I will say, because Satan is there, I will not go. What are you talking about? The helpers and the help belong to the Lord. Satan is a child of perdition. Yeah, holding people in bondage in different places. So I said, no, men of God, let's go. So some people came, followed me from CPM church, you know, from Dipala Bible Church, from Church of God Mission. We went to that. They followed me. We went to that place. Now, when we go to that church, you look at it, you see that the leader, the man of God in charge of that place, there was another woman, prophet. When they announced my presence, as they were singing, the woman started behaving strange. She got, you know, behaved, demonstrated. So people were watching. And the man of God now, in charge of that particular church, he told me, he said, this woman is their prophetess. He says, God is using her. He said, Jenna told me, he said, because of my presence, that as I have come, that he said, my presence has brought in the higher power of the Holy Spirit. That is why the woman is under that kind of another. She doesn't demonstrate up to this extent. But the woman was behaving, even if you want to come and use her, she has a big boot, she doesn't use to strike you something. So, cheers, we have given her space. One of the men of God that followed me, felt that no, this is not acceptable. And himself is also a deliverance minister. So he, in his own mind, he felt that this is demon working in the woman. That kind of congregation, they felt that, oh, higher power has come, and so the woman is under the influence of the higher power. Those that went with me felt that, oh, this is a demonic manifestation. So they now went, that man of God that followed me to go and minister there, because I was the person to minister, but he accompanied me, other men of God. So he now stood up, you know, in the holy as a man of holy being, holy one. He went to the woman, he told the woman, said, as he went to touch the woman, said, I rebuke the spirit doing this in the name of Jesus. As he said, the woman used her toes and struck the man. That man of God just staggered and fell down and then went back to his. So, they were now looking at me to do something, to try to control that situation, to this woman is misbehaving. Because she did that for a long time. In certain times, it was a distraction, but I was just watching her. In my spirit, as I sat down there, I knew that this activity is not, there's no Holy Spirit in this activity. The Holy Spirit is not involved in this thing. I knew. And I looked at her very well. I knew there was even also no demon. Yeah, is that thing it was a normal human demonstration. She needed some attention and she wanted to act as a champion for that moment so that she can attract some attention. That is so what she was doing. It was just a male human exhibition. So you see, at that time, if you follow her with the Holy Ghost, if you go to in the name of Jesus to pray, because there's no Holy Ghost, there's no demon there, this and that, the woman will see you continue to use her mind to do what she was doing. And if you also go to her, to stop her, how can she stop when she knew what she would do? So there was no the Holy Spirit was not involved, no demon power was involved. So how am I going to approach the matter? I look at myself and I say, okay, as far as Holy Spirit is not involved in this thing, and demon is not involved in this thing, I have to follow the woman in her own time. So I stood up. All eyes are looking, I walked towards the woman. So I was walking to the woman, was she demonstrating and using one kind of art to look me so that time. So I gave her a second. I went close to her. I heard her head. I spoke to her ear. I just spoke to her, just a human word, because a human being is just a human being acting. I told her, I said, Lilo, go and sit down. I want to minister now. And after the ministration, try and see me. As I spoke this word into her ear, the woman just calmed down and went and sat down. The whole congregation started clapping. You know, they will give that kind of activity some interpretation. Some people may think that, oh, maybe greater anointing from the harbinger of the last covenant has subdued the spirit there. Some people, well, whatever imagination they will want. The fact is that it was a mental act. It was a mind exhibition, consciously demonstrated by the woman. So you have to approach her on that conscious level of mind to mind. I have to talk to her as a human being. Please, Lilo, I need to minister. But after the ministration, come and see me. So she now knew that after the ministration, she would have an opportunity of coming to see me. And then she had to go and sit down because she had to act in that way to as a mark of respect to me. You see, these are the things we are saying. So, in some churches now, there are a lot of churches, and I know about one church in Aba, somewhere, where, you know, people make merchandise. There are some people that there's a particular, listen, somewhere, where they look at one woman. During the church, the woman uses prophecy to change every situation in the church. Even she used prophecy. Nobody knew that she has a network. She has her own network. Some people, these are really like a big business. Big business. She has some men and women that work with her, young men and that. So this would be their duty to monitor some secret lives of some pastors and some deacons and elders and big men. So if they see that this big man, maybe you misbehave or maybe you talk to a girl, they see this and that. So they will report to the woman. So the woman will go there. Maybe after a month she will come to the church. And she programmed herself such a way that when she starts to speak, everybody like all the pastors, everybody, they believe that Jehovah God is speaking through her. The woman will come to that if you are a deacon and you have entangled yourself somehow the report to the woman, you have entangled yourself with maybe a woman in a certain secret corner, you say the woman will come. They will call your name. If your name is Thomas, say Thomas, 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 the woman will slap you on the way. And you see that slap that you give the woman gives, the people believe it is a chastisement of the Lord. Say, Thomas, so and so, the so and so time you were with the so and so girl. The Lord did rebuke you. All this kind of thing. These people do all this. It took time before some other wise men in that church were. She even used that way to demote the pastor. She even told the pastor one day that the Lord says she's demoted. And the congregation have to work on it and place her own network pastor to be. So all these things are just rigmarole, mental activity going on in different places, you know, mental aggrandizement in the name of religion. Let me tell you, this is the time to worship the Almighty Father in spirit and in truth. And that should be your personal relationship and communication with the spirit of light in Christ that is real. But begin by learning how to, on your own, worship the spirit of the Almighty, bow down to him, be humble, lie low. When you continue to do that, the Spirit of God will begin to minister to you through different ways. You will even have divine visitation. Angelic beings can come to you if you are sincere enough. You know, the Lord himself can come to you. You know, then you begin to understand that yes, the Lord is real. If you don't experience the Lord, you will follow the organized systems of religion, thinking that is the Lord. And that's the plan leading the blind. If the plan leads the blind, you follow to the before you follow. Both of you follow to the distance. Into the gutter. So I pray this morning, this early morning here in Lagos, Nigeria, we are giving this exposition early morning in Lagos, Nigeria. I pray for you, the viewer of this episode, that the Lord will strengthen you, strengthen me, I pray for myself, will strengthen all the sons and daughters of God all over the world, that we should take the path of Jesus Christ. We will practically demonstrate in love, in peace, anywhere we are. Make us to be the embodiment of peace, to give peace to our neighbors, to give love to our neighbors, to become channel for peace to and love and light to flourish in our communities, in our nations. Father Almighty, the message that you've given this morning, some of your sons and daughters, some of your servants all over the world, they do not inculcate the art of bowing down on the ground in their doctrines. Father, give them the ability to do this. Because many of them are also faithful ones. But iron sharpens iron. No one is an island of knowledge. You speak to us through different channels. the channel have used this moment to speak to the people, let them give them the ear to hear, so that they will know the importance of this, as it was done by our father Abraham, as it was done by Moses, the prophets of old, as it is done by the angels of God in heaven, as it was practically demonstrated by our Lord Jesus Christ. Give us the ability to practically be partakers of this act of worship, so that your peace, your blessings, your grace will continue to multiply in our bosom, in our consciousness, in our environment. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you all.